Today I want to preview number 3, Oklahoma versus Kansas State, and all that's coming up after the bumper.
Don't be cornering me. Hold up. Time. You gotta help me with that corner sh**.
What's up, kinfolk? It's RJ Young. I am not on a step milk. Consider hitting the like and subscribe button because I upload a video every single day. It's always college football related, sports related. We have a good time. And today, want to preview number 3, Oklahoma versus Kansas State this weekend at 11 a.m. on Fox, because we all love the 11 a.m. kickoffs. But seeing as most of us are going to be home watching it from our televisions, I don't think it's going to piss us off as much as it would in normal years, because there's been nothing normal about 2020, including Kansas State, Oklahoma, and COVID. So earlier this morning, Monday, Chris Klieman did the Big 12 media conference call and said, look, we had 12 guys that we got back last week to start practice this week, but we also found out we lost 10 more to contact tracing and to COVID positives, which is another way of saying this is the new normal across college football. And he feels like every time they take a couple steps forward, they take 1.5 steps back. And they certainly took a half step back in losing the Unity game at Bill Snyder Family Stadium to Arkansas State. They gave up 265 passing yards to Arkansas State's two quarterbacks, right? In Lane Hatcher and Logan Bonner. Now, Bonner did most of the work, passing for about 204 yards with two tutties, but Hatcher also threw two tutties in this game. And that's really the extent of what that defense is right now. They gave up the booty to Rashad Paul and to Jonathan Adams, and Jamal Jones had 16 rushes for 96 yards. Jonathan Adams had himself a game. This is a guy who was a two-star recruit coming out of Jonesboro, whose only offer was from Arkansas State, which is in Jonesboro. But he looked the part, and he was going straight at those defensive backs. It's a liability for their defense, who, you know, lost their defensive coordinator to Michigan State, and Scotty Hazleton, the guy who was their defensive coordinator last year when Kansas State got the win against Oklahoma. Now, on the defensive side of the ball, it's really about the defensive line and whether or not they're going to be able to take advantage of Oklahoma's only real weakness on the offensive line, which is at left tackle. We'll see how that goes. But more than anything, this is going to be a showcase for Spencer Rattler in front of a national television audience against a dude that we know about in Skylar Thompson, who is feast or famine, man. Like, I watched every bit of that Kansas State-Arkansas State game, and I watched Skylar Thompson completing smash route concepts in a way that I've never seen him execute that sort of pass accuracy before. And then he gets pulled late because Chris Klieman said that they wanted to be able to run the quarterback because they saw some openings there that Thompson was not able to take advantage of, either because he was hurt or because he just didn't have it to go, and they got even worse. Now, the one dude that I think you should be watching for Kansas State is Deuce Vaughn. He's a true freshman who had over 5,000 all-purpose yards coming out of Texas. I think he has it in him to be one of the best players in this podunk league. He's Darren Sproles light, and if they get him the number of touches that I think they should get him, closer to 25 than the 12 that he had, he could be a handful for Oklahoma, including that front seven that is going to get tested, maybe not by Kansas State, but by somebody, because you got Isaiah Thomas at the defensive tackle spot, you got Brian Asamoah at that will linebacker spot, and you're going to need to be able to rotate in and out at defensive end. They're going to need to be great to stop the run against Kansas State and to force them to pass. But if they do that, you got Briley Moore, you got Jabastian out there. I thought the dude to watch for was actually Knowles, but in looking at how they were executing the passing game against Arkansas State, I don't see a whole lot to get upset about there. In as far as the defensive scheme, I expect that Kansas State will be able to employ some coverages that might confuse Spencer Rattler for a time. And it's certainly not going to be like Missouri State, where it felt like everybody was running wide open. And even when they weren't, Rattler was good enough to move around and make an excellent throw. Tremendous arm accuracy and tremendous arm strength. It'll certainly be on display against Kansas State. But more than anything else, I'm looking at this game from the standpoint of Oklahoma and this number 3 ranking, which seems padded because it is, right? We had 76 teams that were eligible to receive votes in the AP Top 25 for Week 3. Next week, the Big Ten gets back into the mix as the AP has decided they're only going to consider teams that are a month out from playing their scheduled football game. So that means that Ohio State, Penn State, Michigan, Minnesota, maybe even Iowa, definitely Wisconsin will get back into the top 25. But even so, Oklahoma was considered a top 10 team by most and top 5 by many with a redshirt freshman at quarterback. And with only two running backs available that we know about, right? So TJ Pledger perhaps gets back into the fold this week. But even then, you're talking about TJ Pledger, Marcus Major, and Seth McGowan, and the true freshman might be the best of those three tailbacks. You don't get Ramondre Stevenson back for another three games. To add to that, Trajan Bridges and Ronnie Perkins probably still out because they're serving the same kind of suspension. So it's a numbers game as much as anything else. And when it's a numbers game, talent usually bears out. In this year where everything is going out the window and we're trying to get in as many football games as we possibly can, we're also just waiting day to day to see what the testing proves or doesn't prove, because we saw a bevy of games get canceled last Friday due to COVID positives, right? Memphis is going to have a second straight week where they don't get to play football. We saw that North Carolina lost this game against Charlotte, was not able to find an opponent for this week, so they're not going to play again until October 3rd. And on it goes, right? So we're hoping that the game kicks off as scheduled on Saturday. We know that Kansas State wants to play. We know that Oklahoma wants to play. But in a broader scheme of things, this game is the first of the next nine that Oklahoma just can't afford to lose. And you got to go back to 2010 for the last time that Oklahoma ran through the month of October unscathed. And this is going to be their best opportunity to do that since then, simply because you have fewer games, but also because the kind of competition that is in this league doesn't seem to be good at all. I mean, the Sun Belt basically took the Big 12's lunch money a couple weeks ago with wins against Iowa State and Kansas State and Kansas. Now, those teams aren't expected to win the Big 12 championship, but then you couple that with how Tulsa played against Oklahoma State, which was bad, had more penalty yards than they had rushing yards, and they still were there in a one-score game with the number 11 team in the country. Again, a padded ranking, but many people liked Oklahoma State to make the college football playoff. And by many people, I mean Reggie Bush, who talks about college football on television for a living, and Desmond Howard, who talks about college football on television for a living. This is not a great look for this league. We're really depending on Oklahoma and Texas to carry the mantle that is the Big 12, and while that is not entirely fair, that's also the way that it has been, and I would like to see this conference blown up. But I got an interesting question from my best friend, Ron, whom I'll talk to a little bit later on in the live show, about is Oklahoma going to get back to this upper echelon of greatness that we see with Clemson, with Alabama, with even Ohio State, and what LSU is currently trying to prove that they have. And my contention has always been Clemson is who Oklahoma was supposed to be. As a matter of fact, when Oklahoma was peaking around 2008, Clemson was just in a transition where Dabo Swinney took over the job just a year later and came home as the interim head coach, told his wife, "We got fired today." And she said, "I thought you said they made you the interim head coach." He said, "Did I stutter?" Because everybody understands that the interim head coach is just going to be there for as long as the season is, and then he's going to get the axe too so that the new guy can come in and try to clean house and get the program back to good. It surprised him and some others when Dabo Swinney was tapped as the head coach at Clemson. And then he put together a program. A couple years in, they win 10 games, and they have won at least 10 games dating back to 2011 and every year, right? He's able to take money that he's supposed to get paid and redistribute that money to his assistant coaches, giving him the highest paid assistant coaching salary pool in the nation, which also led to more continuity at the coordinator positions, which also led to being able to recruit like all hell, getting guys like DeAndre Hopkins and Sammy Watkins in, getting guys like Deshaun Watson in, recruiting the hell out of CJ Spiller and getting something out of him. And then you're in the college football playoff, just stomping a mud hole in Oklahoma for the second time in 2 years. The first being in the Sweatpants Bowl, where Clemson announced itself over Oklahoma's dead body 40-6. And in that time, Lincoln Riley has taken over as head coach for Oklahoma and has put together an outstanding record so far, right? He's 37-6 through 3 years and a game. But I contend that what makes Clemson great is the same thing that what makes, an Alabama great or an LSU great. I don't think that Oklahoma is going to be able to win a national championship with Lincoln Riley calling the plays. He's going to have to hire another version of himself. because I look at Gus Malzahn and I see the Oklahoma experience. He's trying to hand the play calling privileges off to Chad Morris this season, who was able to do something worthwhile at Clemson and really learn the offense while still a high school head coach from Gus Malzahn. So if anybody's going to be able to make that transition work, it's those two guys. But that's just not what's going to happen at Oklahoma. Lincoln Riley's so gifted as a play caller and a play designer that it is difficult for us to imagine that he would be willing to give those privileges up, because everybody in that room, and by that room I mean that coach's office, wants him to call the plays. I think he'd be a better head coach, and I think Oklahoma would be in a better position to win national championships if he didn't, but it would take some growing pains, right? You'd have to take a step back to take two steps forward, getting back to how Kansas State fits into all of this. And that's just not going to happen this year or next year. Next year being probably the best year that Oklahoma has had to win a national championship, or best chance Oklahoma's had to win a national championship, dating back to 2017, when Riley was the head coach and play caller. So we'll see how this goes, but like I see the way that Clemson recruits and I see the way that Oklahoma recruits. Clemson recruits like a national champion. Oklahoma recruits like it expects to win the Big 12. LSU recruits like a national champion. Oklahoma recruits like it expects to win the Big 12. And Alabama and Ohio State. And we'll see how this goes with Ohio State, right? Because they could obviously prove that this theory is wrong with Ryan Day being the play caller for the Ohio State offense. We'll see how it goes. But I look at Mack Brown and what he did in 2005. I look at what Bob Stoops was able to do in 2000. And I go up and down. I look at Urban Meyer and him being able to hire these really gifted coordinators, from Tom Herman to Dan Mullen to run the offense, Larry Fedora to run the offense. And I see that that's probably what's going to take, because you have to have your CEO hat on. You have to be aware of clock management. You have to be aware of the offense and the defense. You have to be a head coach. If Lincoln Riley can pull off winning 9 in a row in the Big 12 conference, cool. I will shut up. But then he's got to win in the college football playoff, because the thing that I try to stress to everyone is every time we think that OU is good, an SEC defense or Clemson's defense proves to us that they are not. So even running the table in the Big 12, not going to get any credit for that if you're Oklahoma. You need to win a playoff game, and then you need to contend in the national title game and probably win a national title for people to talk about Oklahoma in the way that we want them to, instead of like the Buffalo Bills, who show up to a Super Bowl just to get their asses kicked. All right, that's it for me. Deuces.